Aloha, everybody, and welcome to The Experience. I am your host, Jeremy Vaney, and I must apologize up front. I didn't realize during this episode that my microphone, while it was plugged in and the little light was on, indicating that it was working, it wasn't actually hooked into the recording system somehow. So you've got my microphone from the computer, which is fine, except that there was a storm going on, and that microphone takes in every sound. So anytime you're going to hear my voice, there's going to be like a crackly background static. And that is just the giant storm coming through my microphone. But mercifully, when I'm not speaking, I tend to mute my mic. So you won't hear that sound through most of the interview because our guest this week is Thad McCracken, and McCracken do most of the talking. And maybe I should just tell you also, his speech pattern is very fast. He's not a fast talker in the way like, you know, a charlatan trying to railroad a conversation is, but he is a speedy talker. So I remember we had on an Australian ufologist who had a similar speech pattern, and some of you found that hard to take. So I'll just tell you right up front, that is what you're in for. So if that does not appeal to you, this episode will not be for you. But for everyone else, there is a rich occult and personal history that you are about to have your ears assaulted with. So get ready for that. And either way, Thad is both a musician and a writer. In fact, the two books he would like you to know about are Transmissions from Out of Time and The Galactic Dialogue. So do check those out. And he told me that normally he is one of those people who cusses when he speaks, which I can tend to be too. But, you know, we don't do that on this show. So where I could, I edited out swearing, and where I couldn't, I had a little fun with it. All right. Without any further ado, let's get into the occult and why anyone would want to summon a demon in the first place, and what is the demon getting out of this, if anything? What does it all mean? Where is it all coming from? As Jerry Seinfeld used to say, who are these people? For non-subscribers, we're going to find out who these people are after these messages. For subscribers, let's shake hands with Thad McCracken right now. Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome to the podcast on this very rainy day, although it's okay now, but I'm just warning you, it may get rainy at some point and loud, because that seems to happen to me a lot lately. That's probably not the best introduction, but it's what we're going with. Thad McCracken, welcome to the program, sir.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Jeremy. Definitely. And yeah, I don't know how often your shows start with
butt
kissing or light
buttocks
kissing, but I just want to say for everybody that's listening, I've been a fan of your show for a long time. I was actually thinking about it probably like a decade now. I was a big fan of Paratopia and been listening to The Experience. And definitely, I think I heard of your show originally through disinfo.com, which I ended up writing for and ended up running for about a year and a half until it just kind of ended recently. So I just want to say, I'm a fan. I've been of all the podcasts I think I learned from, ran into through Disinfo, I think Paratopia was one of my faves. And I think you guys really sort of inspired me. I mean, you and Jeff both, Lee, but you and what you're doing with The Experience is to, you know, openly talk about like what are some really weird experiences and we'll get into that and just be completely open and upfront about it and just like out, like I found that so refreshing. And I definitely think you and Jeff, I mean, I probably would have ventured in this direction anyways, but you guys were definitely always an inspiration for your willingness to talk about how utterly strange these experiences to get and not really back down from it. So just wanted to give you some props. And I actually had another thing is you, that conference that you had in Hawaii recently with Dennis McKenna and Whitley Strieber, I've been kind of amazed that kind of some more you've gotten the UFO narrative at least a little bit into the mainstream kind of psychedelic narrative, where I ended up hearing Dennis McKenna on Duncan Trussell and referencing UFO phenomenon, which I think still at this point most people in kind of mainstream psychedelia just kind of dismiss. I seem to be one of the few people that really sort of sees the connection between these things. Like I said, it was like hearing that and Duncan Trussell, and weirdly enough even Joe Rogan, which is apparently the biggest podcast on the internet right now. I can't say I've really ever been a fan of that show, but yeah, Dennis McKenna was, in fact, so I saw a clip posted online where they were like, he was talking about Whitley Strieber in that conference and referencing you specifically. So just some props there before we get into the rest of it.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you got my script. I'm very, you delivered it nicely. No one will know.
Completely unprompted. I just, hey, I'm a fan, you know, it's a,
I appreciate it. Well, I guess now I can't debunk everything you're about, so I guess that was good jujitsu.
I know you're gonna try anyways, because like
no,
I'm
it's
well
not
aware
true. It's
that
not true.
Probably,
you know, it's funny because you're one of the few people, because people don't talk to me, I think they're afraid of me, but I don't know what the deal is, but when they do, a lot of them say, hey, you know who you should have on is Thad McCracken, have you had him on? And I say no, and I don't know why. I mean, you know, nice. We talk every now and then on Facebook, and
I was, to be entirely fair, I was in fact on an episode of Paratopia years ago under my real name, which I'm not going to say, and I ended up being kind
big
of
asshole.
You guys, so apologies for that, by the way. So yeah, if you're a real big,
we get that a lot.
If you're a real big Paratopia fan, you might have heard some of these stories before, because I did in fact do, you were doing kind of like a Who Wants to Host Paratopia episodes on a break, and I did do one episode way back in the day.
Excellent.
So yeah, that was like a decade ago, and I was sort of
an asp hole. Like a place where an asp might live.
Because I think I was sort of like excited about getting the chance to do it. You guys just weren't feeling what I was doing. So I was just kind of
King Richard.
So apologize for all that. So you guys ended up not doing the like, let's let other people host their own shows thing. Like, so anyways, keep going.
Well,
but hey, I'm on. We're doing your fans a service. You finally got me on. So
that's right. They demanded, I delivered. All right. So let's get into some of your experiences. They run a little toward the occult, yeah?
Yeah, definitely, but in a weird way that doesn't necessarily align itself with the occult in this day and age. Like what, if you went to an occult convention, which I've done, what those people are talking about is not what I'm talking about, you know? And yet there is a tradition of what I was. I mean, I definitely, what I do, I think it kind of blends blends the worlds of shamanism and the occult. I would say it's probably further on the shamanism side, but it's definitely, you know, influenced by the occult. But I have very different opinions about that stuff. And like, if you asked, you know, your typical, like, hey, how to, you know, for people who teaches how to do magic or whatever, what they would tell you would not even be sort of what I would say. It would literally be like, what is this? Like, I mean, there's enough of a difference there that as much as there's a tradition in what I'm doing is not really big in occult circles. It really is something that it took me a while of writing about this publicly in front of lots of people, like just assuming like, oh, I'm doing this thing that a lot of other people are into, just to be like, oh, wait, no. I'm doing this weird thing that no one else is doing. But I'm glad, I'm glad that people at least enjoyed it and encouraged me to do it.
Well, so wait, yeah, what is it that you're doing, and why are you doing it, and why are you doing it differently than everyone else?
Well, I mean, basically, there's a strain in occult. First of all, why am I doing it? And I have a lot of kind of psychic precognitive experiences now that I can provide kind of concrete proof on. You know, I started keeping a live dream journal. So there's a lot of things where I can say, hey, I said this, and then 6 months later, this really weird thing that I had a dream about, or I had a spirit communication, and then this absolutely ended up happening in the future. I have a lot of those, and like kind of concrete things, like, you know, it's kind of hard to argue that this happened because it was all posted publicly. The one thing that I don't have any proof of necessarily is like that I was summoned into the occult by an almost Jeff Richman Shroud Man type figure. But that's exactly what happened. So one day, and this is at like the lowest point in my life, I was kind of unemployed, and my drinking had really kind of spiraled out of control. Like it was really getting into sort of dangerous territory.
That's called anti-structure for all you trickster fans out there. Go on.
yeah, for trickster fans, exactly. And this is what's so common is it's like when so many people have these awakenings, it is at that exact point where like it's like you're delving into rock bottom territory. So at one point, I'm taking like you know, pot nap in the middle of the day, and this entity, again, kind of like black hooded entity, showed up in my room, and it clapped its hands twice in the exact same way that a hypnotist awakens its subject and like clap clap, wake up. And when that happened, I bolted upright in my bed, and just like, you know, like as if the thing had jarred me awake. And instantly I realized that something inside of me had essentially broken, and that for years, well, I mean, to back up further than that, I started playing around with things like astral projection and psychedelics when I was 18, right? Like I was like a teenager, and this was like 10 years later when I was roughly 28. And so there was a decade of my life where I'd had these weird experiences, but like honestly, like everyone who's raised in Western society, I just sort of ultimately just dismissed it. Well, I mean, it's like I acknowledged it, and then at the same time, I was in denial about it because, you know, you're just like, well, I've been raised to believe that this is nonsense. So even though I'm experiencing it, it's like, yeah, but I'm just not buying it. And so when this happened and I was unhypnotized, I essentially realized like, oh, that's my problem. Like I haven't, you know, it's like I'm, and not only that, I mean, I felt really alienated. It's so funny. I was in a band making music at this time. You can listen to one of my songs where there's like a lyric. There's a song that's really just sort of a depressing song about how much that this stuff was alienating me. Cause I'm like playing in a band with like writing lyrics for a band where like the other guys in the band have absolutely no clue that I'm talking about and are all atheists in all honesty. And I'm writing about these weird experiences. So there's like even a song reflecting like, you know, that there, I knew that there was something wrong. And so I just sort of, when it snapped its fingers or clapped its hands, as it were, and woke me up, all of a sudden I realized like, oh, wait, you shouldn't be like ashamed of this because your culture tells you not real. It's like, this is something like you should be proud of that. Like, you know, like a sorcerer, a magician, that's like the best thing you can be in life. These are like serious skills and you need to use these rather than running away from these. You need to embrace this aspect of yourself and try your best to use it to make your life better. And also it was like, you need to start doing magic. So I was like summoned into the occult by this weird astral projection hooded entity. And I mean, and as I said, I have no evidence for that necessarily, you know, it's not something I have concrete evidence, but what I can say is like, I am pretty much the only one that you're going to talk to about summoning demons and stuff like that, that has absolutely no interest in a culture whatsoever. I have never been attracted to goth anything. Like I like more like kind of psychedelic colors. So as much as this claim that I was summoning the occult, I don't really have compelling evidence. It is very strange that somebody who has no interest in this stuff culturally whatsoever ends up writing a book about acknowledging a conversation with its holy guardian angel. And my latest one that I'm working on finishing right now is about a conversation with an ancient demonic entity that I summoned because I was eventually told that I was in contact and how weird that experience is. So again, yeah, I, this is how I got into the occult. Like something summoned me into that pursuit. And you know, this is probably one of the few shows where
I mean, do you feel like you could have said no if you want to, or do you think it was a false question?
No, yeah, that's what's so funny is like I don't think that I would have had the ability to resist if I wanted to. Like I really don't. It's and I started practicing magic the next day. I started working like basic sigil stuff the next day, you know, like the very next day. And some of it seemed to kind of have an immediate effect, you know, pretty immediately. So there is a particular branch of magic the other reason why when I say that what I do differs pretty much from what everybody else would do is there's a branch in magic that I was influenced by called chaos magic. And I'm honestly, I've only read a couple books about this, but the entire point, to chaos magic is to cater, the practice to your own subjective experience. So the whole point is to kind of, you know, make your world and say, hey, I know traditional magic would say this would work, but I'm actually going to cater it like I like this band. So rather than using this band or in this ritual, I'm going to use something that I like and I'm going to pick terms that mean something to me. And with my experience as an astral projection, that's kind of right along the way that the astral world works, which is something that I didn't really believe necessarily until I kind of experienced it myself. So I really think there's something profound in chaos magic that there's something profound to the idea of kind of being a little more flexible with the terms of what you're doing and creating your own kind of subjective microverse. And so because I was influenced by that, that's what I did. And then you realize that I've taken it to a place where that's not what other people were doing. I've made the joke constantly that it's a funny story with the band Pink Floyd. They were making psychedelic music back in the 60s, and they thought they were making psychedelic music that was heard about psychedelic bands in San Francisco, which was a psychedelic hub. And, you know, they thought they were making that kind of music because this is before great information technology. And so they started this band that had a way darker, weirder sound. And then years after the fact, they hear these San Francisco bands and they're just like, what? We thought we were doing this idea that they were doing psychedelic music, but it sounded completely different than what they were doing. I mean, it's sort of, I guess, similar to my experience with the occult in a way.
Let me ask you something.
Yeah, yeah.
So it sounds like the mixing and matching of different things from the occult to shamanism and even dream work, whatever you want to throw in there.
Yeah.
And the different types, the different subcategories of all that gets to a question that Jeff and I brought up quite a bit toward the end of Paratopia, which is, and really I think it was Jeff's question more than mine, or his insight to even have the question, is, does it matter what you're doing? Is it, do the rituals actually matter, or is it simply your intention and the object of your intention is it could be anything?
Well, yeah, actually, what I think is I think this is sort of what chaos magic was pointing out, is that these kind of antiquated rituals really, how do we cut this down to the most fundamental level? And I think you're absolutely right. I mean, what specifically would differentiate what I do from most people is, one, my practice is very much based around weed and the combination between weed and astral projection. And when I talk about being summoned into the occult, what's weird is, you know, it seems like the occult would be a weird thing to be summoned into. And yet that idea, it goes back forever in occult circles. That is the one area, not even necessarily shamanism, where this idea that you can combine marijuana and astral projection specifically is there. And I started, you know, playing around with this stuff when I was 18. So by this time I got summoned into it, I had in fact been dancing around a weird state of using weed and kind of focused meditation techniques to create communicative contact states. And there's hundreds of years of history of that. And yet, so my practice, you're right, I think more it's about tapping into and communicating with the spirit world and using that information to kind of influence your reality. And I'm far more focused on inner work, and there's nobody else in the occult writing about that. And I always say this kind of thing and people are like, oh, they think it's I'm being cocky. And it's no, I would love to have a peer. I would love to have like somebody I can share notes with. I didn't know there was no one else doing this. Like, I didn't know this was my weird thing. And, you know, it's like I happen to be the one person. So my focus is more about attaining the states of consciousness and kind of working with your inner states that can be achieved through that and just through basic astral projection and lucid dream work and stuff like that. And I don't know, most other people's occultism, as far as I know, I mean, most of the stuff I read, it's really about these complicated rituals and, you know, it's very like a materialistic way of looking at things. It's like, oh, I have to light, you know, and it's like combining like astrology and like, I got to light the candles in this time. And then I have to have this kind of specific dagger to do, you know.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And The Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to The Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
Well, see, this is interesting because you look at occult rituals like that, and you're right. That sounds like very materialistic, and it sounds like it's trying to, in some sense, be scientific or at least repeatable and organized, but even that is different than, say, like a nature culture who would say, for instance, a medicine person or a shaman even would say, like, the ingredients that you're using aren't just ingredients, they're living beings, and you have to ask them permission to use them. You have to sort of intuit or speak to the plants, the rocks, the whatever it is that's involved to see if they want to be involved. So is there that level of relationship and consideration for the things that go into rituals in westernized rituals, or is it all just, as we're talking about, object lessons?
It's interesting that you bring that up, because in my world, yes, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I just said, like, my practice, I mean, largely it's around around using marijuana to, and it's one thing that people don't talk about, was that is that marijuana, it kind of dampens your dreams to an extent, but it hyper accentuates the hypnagogic state. And so kind of using that to induce in a brand of that and inner focus techniques to induce that kind of expanded hypnagogic state is there. And yeah, I mean, I look at that as me having a bit of a relationship with weed. And I always make the joke that, like, I don't trust a person if they don't like weed, but if they, you know, I trust weed if it doesn't like a person. And, you know, it's so, and psilocybin as well. I've done psilocybin rituals and I'm increasingly kind of focused on that. And yeah, I definitely think, I look at it in the shamanic sense that my experience is there's just this feeling of an entity and a relationship there. And like, I have such a strong relationship to psilocybin. So it's almost like my entire spiritual practice has really been like trying to figure that out. Cause that's the first thing that got me into spirituality, as I took mushrooms when I was 18 years old. And just like, I mean, the best, it's just, it was rather than being like, this, I'm just hallucinating. It's sort of like, no, I'm sort of staring in the face of a higher intelligence that's made of pure kind of mutating otherworldly art. And you know, and so when I started reading, say, like things like Carlos Castaneda, it was like, you know, eye-opening to the fact that you're not the only one that's looked at it that way. Like, that is one way of looking at this experience. But, you know, so, but then again, like half the people that I did psychedelics with back when I was a teenager and started doing when I was 18 are like total yuppies, and they might still do them and they've never looked at them that way. So there's always been this fundamental question of like, why me? Like, why do some people take hallucinogens and they don't hallucinate anything? And if you want to go look up, if anyone's listening, you can look up, there's a couple great pieces of art by an artist, a visionary artist called Luke Brown. If you look up Luke Brown's Baphomet or Luke Brown's Jester Terrestrial, that's kind of the closest approximation. It's like, I see this stuff just coming out of the walls. And so you're right. I think and that's the more shamanic way of looking at that this is your ally, or that you, and you know, I think there's absolutely something there. I think, you know, there's a cycle of lives, and I don't know what on earth I did to cultivate a relationship with these type of psilocybin gods, but I did something that I don't remember at all.
Well, so do you think that
led to all this?
From your studies, even, and from your practices, have you a thought to parse out or just done it? Whether or not you're coming to the same, would you be coming to the same place? Would you be interacting in the same way with the same beings, doing something in the classical occult ritual way, in the way that you're doing it, or in the nature culture way? Like, do all of these ways bring you to the same place, or are they completely different experiences?
I don't want to, you know, overstate the use of drugs. I also do sober meditation, and I think half of the most compelling experiences in my life I've had, like I was talking about astral projection, and that has nothing to do with drugs whatsoever. I am different than a lot of people will say. You can do anything with psychedelic drugs. You can do anything without psychedelic drugs that you can with them. And to that I say, nope. Not in my experience. It's different, man. It is. Like, a psychedelic hallucinations are... I would actually say that in my experience, like astral projection, the more sober stuff I do and in dream work, it's more coherent, you know, it's less alien, you know, we're on
a second.
Whitley Strieber's network. I think,
let me ask it this way. So dream work and astral projection, that reminds me. So in Hawaiian culture, old Hawaiian culture, dream time was even more important than wake time. You know, these were people who were masters of dreaming. And so.
Absolutely.
That and so, but you've got an entire depth of knowledge and wisdom about that you would teach to an apprentice, so on and so forth. Then you've got the books, the Western occult books that talk about dream and astral projection and stuff like that, and New Age books, and give you sort of a how-to, and maybe they tell you what, I don't know, what crystals to use to bring you to a certain headspace. I don't know what it would be. And then you've got just guys like you and me who stumble into stuff.
Yeah.
Are all three, I mean, do you have to go through the meticulous, do you have to be brought up in a certain culture to have that experience? Is it different than the other two things? Or do you see that they're all just sort of different paths to the same thing?
I think there is a level of individualization. I mean, yeah, to kind of just wrap up the last question, there's a lot of people that think there's a difference between psychedelic, and I'm like, the psychedelic experience, at least in my world versus sober things that I've done, there's a level of alienness to it. It's a level of weird, inhuman, like, no, other experiences don't get me to that specific place, which is this place of just, you know, staring at an intelligence that is beyond humanity and honestly lacks humanity in a way. So there's that. But as to whether it all gets you to the same place, I would again say I think it varies. I think there's a cycle of lives that you've been leading. And I think, and again, this is something that I didn't believe in at all until I started playing around with astral projection. But then you just start having these experiences where entities are sort of just explaining this stuff to you. And then it's again one of these things that you look and you're like, oh, that's obviously a Buddhist idea that's been around forever. So this concept of cycle and lives, or I just think there's a history in all of us that that we're not seeing. There's kind of an occluded history that all of us have. And I think that probably influences where you go when you enter these states, that there's a storyline that you're not aware of that I think influences where these states take you. And I still kind of refer to myself as an occultist rather than shamanism. I wouldn't go so far as to recur myself as a shaman, because you're talking, and although you're right, I'm more in tune with dream work and say psychedelic ritual. So what I do is more in tune with shamanism than it is the occult in a way, but with the occult, there's the difference. Shamanism always strikes me as a more kind of nature-based practice, and it's more sort of about communing with the natural world, and the occult is sort of more communing with art. And I think that is the difference. It's almost kind of more communing with humanity's, imagination rather than necessarily the natural environment. And of course, I'm an artist who makes psychedelic music, and most of my rituals have been sort of based around making psychedelic music and offering it to the gods. And I made a psychedelic film too. And same deal, the last psychedelic ritual I did was to watch this film. So yeah, I mean, that's really where it's in the occult. And then the other thing that I think puts it more into the occult is the weed astral projection kind of connection. That goes back in the Western esoteric tradition forever and has been largely forgotten. Like, I seem to be the only one keeping that alive, which is weird because weed's legal. Like, this is now something that in a lot of states, like, anybody can just go out and experiment with, like, completely legally. And yet, despite weed being legalized, I don't know anybody else other than me that's talking about this right now, which has been sort of strange.
Is there a difference between, like, when you first saw that shrouded being who clapped at you,
yeah,
your reaction to that, how you felt about that, or even your state of mind at that time, versus conjuring something? Is there a difference, or is it the same feeling, the same state of mind, the same? I don't know. I mean, what did you feel? Did you feel awe? Did you feel fear? Did you feel confused?
In that particular experience, well, it was just such an immediate. I mean, it was literally, imagine, I've never been hypnotized. And it's funny, I've tried. I'm just not one of the people that's easy to hypnotize, which is a weird aspect of hypnosis in general. So I've tried, but it honestly felt like that. And with that shroud man, it wasn't a hypnagogic state. And it was in really a sleep paralysis state that this happened. And the entity was there. But yeah, I mean, I have like a vague memory of seeing the shroud man. Like, that was almost like after I got up, it was like, what the hell's going on? Oh, there was a weird shrouded man there that clapped his hands. Like, I heard the hand claps clear as day. Like, I weirdly enough, I imagine it was somewhat similar to what it's like to get woken up from hypnosis. So, like, I really do. Like I don't know what's going on in a dream state. All of a sudden, I'm awoke and awakened, and something within me has completely shifted. You know, it was definitely weird like that. But yes, I have later summoned an entity and also done experiments where these entities were trying to pull me out of my body. And that very much happens more in the sleep paralysis state, which is another thing that's fascinating. And this is in ufology where I feel like I do have an interesting point, because for years, mainstream scientists have pointed to sleep paralysis to attribute UFO contact from. And what never gets mentioned in this conversation is that this is astral projection, at least per Robert Monroe's methods of astral projection, which I definitely, this is how I got into astral projection at age 18. I started playing around with this. And what's so funny about Robert Monroe is Robert Monroe gets categorized. Everybody really just sort of ignores him at this point for the most part. I mean, not entirely, but to a large extent. And the reason is because his stuff got categorized totally in new age, like very new agey. Like he sold a lot of new agey books. So I think people have the tendency to just look at this guy like, you know, he's just an idiot new ager. Because, I mean, if you look at the covers of his books or where they were filed in bookstores back in the day, that's where we get. But, in, you know, I just started playing around with it because I had such weird experiences with psychedelics. My mom had tried and had some success with it. And it really is, you're intentionally inducing a sleep paralysis state. And then the theory is that you can roll out of your body from that sleep paralysis state. And what's very bizarre about that is, like I said, like mainstream kind of materialist scientists I've been for years been like, oh, sleep paralysis is just, or these UFO abductions are just sleep paralysis states. And I'm like, well, as someone who's played around intentionally with sleep paralysis, yeah, I've kind of reproduced some contact encounter like experiences, like straight up. So I think there is something there. But then the question goes to, well, what on earth is sleep paralysis? Like, you know, the materialists want that conversation to end right there. You know, oh, we solved it. Problem solved. It's sleep paralysis. And then it doesn't take a minor amount of investigation to be like, there are people throughout history that have intentionally induced sleep paralysis as a means to communicate with the spirit world. And as somebody who's played with that myself, I can say, yes, it absolutely worked. And that, when I talk about, I mean, psychedelics are one thing, but when I talk about having to deal with, you know, the experiences that I had as a young man, I mean, it taking me 10 years until some entity came back and broke the part of me that couldn't buy into this stuff, you know, that it was a lot of the astral projection experiences that I was as much in like denial about, like, you know, as the weird, you know, psychedelic talking to aliens thing, the astral projection was almost maybe even more jarring.
And that jingle means our time is up. My thanks to Thad McCracken for coming on The Experience. Thank you all for listening. We will see you next week, and please do tune in. Next week's is near and dear to my heart. I won't say any more than that because I want you to actually tune in. I know. And if I tell you what it is, you might tune out. So do tune in. And if you're a non-subscriber, please do consider clicking that subscribe tab, getting all of this episode and all of every episode for a pittance, commercial-free, along with everything Whitley has to offer, from Dreamland commercial-free in its entirety to all the special content, unique content to this website. Go ahead, click the subscribe tab. I dare you. And if you are a subscriber, thank you, as always, for your patronage and for your insightful comments in the comment section. I expect nothing less for this week's episode. Take care, everybody.